In this video, I want to begin to cover some of the structures that are related to the digestive system, also known as the GI tract or the alimentary canal. Now, obviously, digestion and digestive system starts in the oral cavity at the mouth, where we will chew the food with mastication, and we've already learned some muscles of mastication. We'll talk about teeth in a little while. We know that there are salivary glands. Salivary glands are not represented on this model. And the tongue makes some lingual lipases. So we have salivary amylases and lingual lipases that will begin the digestion of food. Then we pass from the oral cavity, we go through the oropharynx and posterior to the laryngopharynx into a muscular tube made up of smooth muscle. The upper portion is skeletal muscle. As we go down, we go through smooth muscle. This muscular tube is called the esophagus. And we learned when we did the diaphragm that the esophagus passes through the esophageal hiatus of the diaphragm at roughly the T10 vertebral level, where we will pass into the stomach. Now, the stomach is a bag to hold food, is a storage area, but there is digestion occurring in the stomach. And the stomach has what is known as a greater curvature and a lesser curvature. And where the esophagus meets the stomach is called the cardia of the stomach, or the cardiac region. If we draw a horizontal line across from that cardia region, we see there's a dome on the stomach. That dome is known as the fundus of the stomach. Then the stomach proceeds down and curves off toward the right and posterior. That region of the stomach is known as the pyloric region, or the pylorus. Now, if I open the stomach on this model, we can see inside that we have lots of folds inside the stomach. These folds are known as rugae. These folds serve as an increased surface area within the stomach, allowing the stomach to distend as we fill it with food. Also allows for more contact of the food in the stomach with the walls of the stomach as the stomach is churning the food. And you will learn in lecture that the majority of what the churning is for is to expose the food to the acid environment of the stomach, which breaks down the peptide bonds in our proteins. So we begin the breakdown of proteins in the stomach. The main body of the stomach then leads off to the right in the area that we call the pylorus, or the pyloric region. Then we pass through an area known as the pyloric sphincter. The pyloric sphincter is a muscular valve, smooth muscle, that regulates the outflow of food from the stomach. Once we pass through the pyloric sphincter, we are now in the small intestine. The small intestine has three regions: the duodenum, the jejunum, and the ileum. The duodenum on this model passes posterior and to the right, and it is attached to the green of the plaque for this model, because the duodenum in the body is considered retroperitoneal. It is fused to the posterior abdominal wall. It passes posterior and to the right and then loops back around toward the left, so we can see the head of the pancreas cradled by the duodenum. We'll come back to some of the other structures in this area in just a moment. The duodenum, as it passes back toward the left, then rises from the posterior abdominal wall and becomes the next portion of the small intestine, the jejunum. I'm going to remove a portion of the large intestine so we can see where the duodenum rises from the posterior abdominal wall. At this point, it becomes jejunum. Jejunum is the next portion of the small intestine, and it winds throughout the abdominal cavity, connected to the posterior body wall by a mesentery, which we cannot see on this model. And approximately the first 2/5 of this freed small intestine will be the jejunum. The lower 3/5 will be ileum. On this model, it is not possible to tell where jejunum becomes ileum, but the ileum will wind and wind and work its way off to the lower right side of the model, where we see the ileocecal junction. The ileocecal junction. And there's a valve here. Many books call this the ileocolic junction, and this valve would be the ileocecal valve, the valve between the cecum and the ileum. We do not want the the beginning of the formation of fecal matter in our large intestine to back up into our small intestine. So let's recap small intestine. The three regions are the duodenum, which is about 9 inches long, then the jejunum, and then the ileum meeting the cecum. I'm going to put this portion of large intestine back on the model. The cecum is the beginning of the large intestine. It is a bag-like structure on the low right-hand side of the abdominal cavity. And hanging from the cecum, we can see here on the model, the appendix, or the vermiform appendix. The cecum leads to the ascending colon. The ascending colon ascends on the right side of the body, and then when it gets to the liver, it turns at what we call the hepatic flexure or the right colic flexure and goes across the front of all of the other structures to pass to the other side of the abdomen. As it crosses, it is no longer the ascending colon, it is now the transverse colon. Now remember I said that this happens when it gets to the liver. In this model, the liver has been lifted so we can see some of the other structures. Anatomically, the stomach and the liver should be much closer down so that the liver is actually touching this colic flexure, hepatic flexure or right colic flexure. Then we come across as the transverse colon. When the transverse colon gets to the left side of the body, it meets with an organ known as the spleen, and we have another bending. That bending is called either the splenic flexure, because it's associated with the spleen, or the left colic flexure, because it is on the left side of the body. At the left colic flexure, we turn and we descend down the left side of the body as the descending colon. Now, the ascending colon and the descending colon are both considered to be retroperitoneal. That means they are fused to the posterior body wall. As we get to the lower left side, the colon actually rises from the posterior abdominal wall and goes over the brim of the pelvis to midline, and that is called the sigmoid colon. If I turn this model very carefully, you can see the sigmoid colon is not attached to the board. There is some yellow here. That represents a mesentery called the sigmoid mesocolon. So the descending colon was fused to the posterior body wall, if we view this board as the posterior body wall. So it was retroperitoneal. But when we get to the sigmoid colon, we are no longer retroperitoneal. We have a mesocolon. That brings us over the rim of the pelvis and to the midline of the pelvis, where we then turn again and go straight down as the area of the colon known as the rectum, and then we end at the anus. Now I want to put the transverse colon back onto the model and take a closer look. We can see all along the length of the large intestine, we cut it open here so we can see the ileocecal valve, but all the way along the length of this large intestine are these lobular type structures. Those are known as haustra. So each one of those is a haustra. We can also see running along the length of the large intestine, here we see part of it, and here we see a band of it, three longitudinal bands of smooth muscle. They start at the appendix and they run the entire length of the large intestine. Those are smooth muscle. They are known as tenia coli muscles. Tenia coli muscle. They help to shorten the length of the large intestine. So let's recap large intestine. We start at the cecum, and off of the cecum we have the appendix. Then we have the ascending colon, the right colic flexure, also known as the hepatic flexure, the transverse colon, the left colic flexure, also known as the splenic flexure, the descending colon, the sigmoid colon, the rectum, and the anus. Now I want to talk a little bit more about that area we called the porta hepatis when we looked at the liver video. If you haven't seen the liver video yet, go see the liver video. Let's talk about inferior portion of the liver, the area known as the porta hepatis. In this model, we can see the hepatic artery coming into the liver.
We don't see very well that it splits into a right and a left hepatic artery. We see the portal vein coming into the liver. But what I really want to point out on this liver is the biliary tree, the ducts that carry the bile from the liver. We can see the right and the left hepatic ducts uniting to form the common hepatic duct. We can see the gallbladder with its cystic duct. That cystic duct and common hepatic duct unite to form what is known as the common bile duct. That common bile duct should run down to the duodenum. Now I'm going to remove the transverse colon on this model so we have a better view. Here we had the duodenum forming the C-shaped loop around the head of the pancreas. And we can see the common bile duct coming down into the duodenum. And here we've got a section of the duodenum open so we can look inside. And inside the duodenum we can see several circular folds which run the entire length of the small intestine. These are called plicae circularis. Plicae circularis. But also in the duodenum we see a small little raised papilla right here. This is called the hepatopancreatic ampulla. The hepatopancreatic ampulla. Its name tells you something about hepatico, liver, and pancreatic. This structure here, cradled by the duodenum, is the pancreas. The pancreas has a head, a body, and a tail that reaches all over to the spleen. Now the pancreas has many functions, but in digestion, it forms pancreatic lipases. So we're going to have bile coming from the liver. Bile is going to emulsify fats. Pancreatic lipases are also going to digest fats. So it would make sense that we're working on fats via the bile system, we're working on fats from the pancreas, that we would run the two together. So just before the common bile duct enters the hepatico-pancreatic ampulla, where we will find a sphincter, sometimes referred to as the sphincter of Oddi, it will be joined by the pancreatic duct, which will be bringing in those pancreatic lipases and other pancreatic enzymes. Also, we see an accessory pancreatic duct which will pass posterior to the common bile duct to enter the duodenum all by itself. So there's quite a bit going on in this small region. Let's recap quickly. The gallbladder with its cystic duct, the right and left hepatic ducts make the common hepatic duct with cystic duct make the common bile duct. The common bile duct will pass posterior to the duodenum and come down to enter into the duodenum at the hepatico-pancreatic ampulla. Just before it enters, it will be joined by the pancreatic duct. And then the pancreatic duct has its own smaller duct called the accessory pancreatic duct, which will enter into the duodenum all by itself.